quick stories that I wrote in 1988. And I think I was like in sixth grade then. Nothing great was ever achieved without enthusiasm. This can be important in my life with freestyle skateboarding. If I just keep thinking about it, I will keep all my skateboarding up. Then someday, I'll become a pro like I always wanted to. Like sometimes when I try a new trick, if I can't do it, I just say forget it. Now, when I think about that saying, I'm going to do it.
You can do it!
Yeah, John! Going into the street, ladies and gentlemen, John Trimble!
Determination gives you the resolve to keep rolling forward in spite of the roadblocks that lay before you. Now, there will always be someone who will tell you no, you cannot do that, or they will criticize you. But don't take that as a failure on your part, but instead a missed opportunity on their behalf, because they may not be fully aware of your skills, knowledge, and experience, and what you're capable of. Instead, take it as an opportunity to continue towards your goals and dreams and to make them a reality.
The three keys for success: interest, motivation, persistence, and determination.
You know, life is full of opportunities, and when you can be at the right place at the right time, you'll see a lot of magic happen. But if you can't be at the right place at the right time, it does not mean that whatever you're interested in is not for you. It just means that you got to keep pushing forward and keep trying.
And just because things don't always work out as you plan, it doesn't mean you failed. It just means that you gotta continue to persist in your goals and dreams until they become a reality. And when you do, you'll see the rewards at the end of the tunnel. And that, my friend, is how winning is done. Check this out. No way. You know who that is? That's Omar Hassan. I used to skate with that guy in Gal Web demos.
This young man, his mom and his brother came all the way from San Diego. They've never been in our shows before. He's a little nervous. I can kind of tell he kind of twitches, but he has a great time. He is 13 years old, and he's going to show you basic tricks, and he'll lead into some really great tricks on skateboards. Called skateboard freestyling. Everybody can do it. Just grab a board and have a good time. He's got knee pads on because you do fall on your knees. Always try to wear as much gear as you can. What we're going to do, we're kind of a little bit of a competition over here with that music. I would love to trade them speakers anytime. Oh, if we can just plug in, it would be great. But in the meantime, we'll turn our own speakers on. If it's too loud, kind of back up. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get him in here. John Trimble. Oh, I forgot to tell you. When you make noise and you root for the kids, make believe you're rooting for your own children too. I love to give things away, and that's my thank you to you. So the more noise you make, the radder the kids get, and I get the thank you. So let's hear it again for John Trimble. Come on, everybody. Keep it going. Come on. Check him out, check him out. Come on, everybody, all one time. We gotta cheer for this young man, John Trimble from San Diego, California. Riding a wet bar soap in your bathtub? Truthfully, it really is. So give your kids credit. That big hand for John Trimble, Team Vision. Our next rider, his name is Omar Hassan. I keep forgetting last name, so tell me your name on the slide here. He was in the audience the last show, and he goes, I can do kind of good. Do you think I can be in your show? I go, I'm not sure. I have the time to see your ride. Make sure you don't have to be the best to be in my show. Just want you to make sure you're safe. Well, I gave him a little tryout. I'll let the audience tell me if you think I picked the kind of good kid here. First time ever in one of our shows. Ladies and gentlemen, Omar from Vision. Let's have a big hand right now for this young lad. Come on, everybody.
And now, years later, I see him on a Thrasher book. I'm guessing that this took place during the early to mid-1990s, sometime after he became a pro. Let's check it out. A radical skateboard book by Kevin Thatcher and Brian Brannon. Just kind of give you the basics for, I guess, kids that are just beginning or wanting to get stoked off of skateboarding.
Let's see what they have in here for freestyle. Curious. Here we go, types of skating.
It's like they say here, vertical and ramp skaters have taken freestyle tricks to, like, tricks like finger flips and shove-its to great heights, even upside down. Watching today's top pro skaters will leave no doubt in your mind that anything is possible. Street terrain. Talking about street skating. Freestyle. One of the most underrated arts of skateboarding today is freestyle, utilizing an otherwise featureless flat surrounding surface, such as a sidewalk or basketball court. Today's freestyler throws moves that border on the physically impossible. Modern street skating itself owes so many moves to freestyle that we couldn't even begin to list them all here. Let's just say that most of the moves that are now popular in street style were first pioneered by freestyle aficionados many years ago. Huh. That's cool. So they're giving some credit to freestylers.
Let's see if they have any freestylers actually skateboarding in this book here. Maybe in the sequence section. Oh, here we go. Down here at the bottom we have this says original street person, Steve Rocco. Shows the basic ollie to tell on a high curb.
You know, he did some street skating back in the day, but he also did a lot of freestyle. From what I remember, he mostly did freestyle. Huh. More sequences of street skaters. So here we have Rodney Mullen.
It says, freestyle and street style trick innovator Rodney Mullen reaches for the sky with an ollie mute catch. I wonder why they called it a mute catch. And we just call it a mute grab back then.
Holy, what?
You see this kid? His name is Kobe Newell.
I used to skate with that guy at the Mike McGill skate park.
With Jordan Richter, anyway, Alfonso Rawls, of course Mike McGill, and many others. He was really good at mini ramp. Let's see what they say about him here. This is a well-protected young ripper. Skate safely at Mike McGill's Carlsbad, California skate park. Almost all skate parks require full safety gear, including helmet and knee and elbow pads.
Yeah, they didn't even mention his name in here. Crazy.
Here we have young Danny Way in an article about coping with unstoked parents. I'm going to guess that this article is about parents that are just really worried about their kids getting injured. Maybe in a sense it was prophetic, considering he's gotten pretty seriously injured, but he's come back, done pretty well. Huh. Skate parks. Title skate parks. Here we have amateur skate associations. We have National Skateboard Association. We have the California Amateur Skateboard League, where I competed in both of those back then in the 1980s. Did pretty well in those. Rest in peace, Sonia Catalano. She passed away recently. Did an awful lot for skateboarding.
Skaters, our children that are interested in skateboarding tend to be very active, very creative, and very not self-oriented, but individualistic. Oriented in their sports. And it's really important, being an ex-school teacher, I know this for sure, to give children like this some place they can go to do the activities they're interested in. One of our main purposes as an organization is to promote skateboarding, both as a recreational activity and as a serious competitive endeavor.
Speaking of doing a lot for skateboarding, you know, how they mentioned in the book how freestylers did a lot for skateboarding. And we did. You know, we are some of the original pioneers of the technical tricks that you see a lot of skaters do today. You know, when it comes down to that,
A lot of us freestyle skateboarders, we had to learn early on how to be our own promoters, our own marketers, and entrepreneurs. And I mean, that's kind of cool. We had to learn that early on because we weren't receiving a whole lot of the kind of recognition we deserved. And although that's kind of unfortunate, it was kind of a blessing. Take, for instance, I started up my own mural painting and custom artwork business. That lasted all the way from 1995 through 2005, so about 10 years. I also think of Don Brown and Pierre Andre, who started up Etney Skate Shoe Company. Right around the same time that Etney started, Steve Rocco and Rodney Mullen started World Industries. Lynn Cooper started up his own board company called Reverse Freestyle. Dale Grogan started up a board company also called Ground Effects, and I skated for his team. Recognize my sponsors, Tracker Trucks, Van Shoes, and Kryptonic Wheels, who supported me for several years. And I also want to recognize my oldest brother, who got me on the flow list before I wrote in to them with more videos to get actually on the teams.
John Trimble, John Trimble. Vans and Tracker.
If it wasn't for my oldest brother to help me out with that, a little bit more of a challenge. He was kind of like my promoter when I was just starting out as a kid. Showed me around to different skate spots, introduced me to different professional skaters, took me to the contests and some demos, helped me get on my first shop sponsor, which was called Rock Sox out of Escondido, California. So yeah, he did an awful lot for me, and you know, we both had a lot in common. That really made skateboarding more enjoyable and fun, to have someone there like a family member. Not only there to help out, but to also be a friend. You know, I'm actually pretty grateful for Lynn Cooper as well, because he really did a whole lot for me. Him and my brother Terry were pretty good friends. Lynn actually put together a really nice skate video for me in 1989. So that I could send it off to different sponsors.
We're gonna go into John's room for a minute. Oh, look at, there's John. He's fast asleep with his favorite toys. Look, there's all of John's first place trophies. Two of them for first place overall in Castle 2 years in a row. There's more of his trophies. Those are all his fifth place and plaques and stuff. There's his fingerboard collection. He likes to skate a lot. Maybe we should wake him up so we could do this skateboard video.
John Trimble, age 13, has been the overall champion in his age group the last 2 years while competing in the California Amateur Skateboard League. John's best events are freestyle, slalom, and high jump, although he does well when he competes in the ramp and street style contests also. John says being successful in school is also important to him. He is an A and B student.
I find myself alone again. All John, when you hear your music.
Yeah, John.
Took a lot of really nice photos as well. My mom and my brother, and they took a lot of pictures and videos of me skating. A few other photographers that were just starting out, and they had professional cameras, and they took some photos of me as well. Magazine-worthy photos. Aside from having a lot of appreciation for my sponsors and being in the Gail Webb demos, getting paid to skate in those shows, and being able to skate in a commercial and a couple of TV shows, and you know, much appreciation for my mom taking us around to the different auditions and everything, and the contests as well. But at the same time, I'm a bit resentful. If they had treated freestylers the same way back then that they treated everyone else, I guarantee you we would have been more in the magazines, we would have been paid more, we've been in more in the videos, and we would have all gotten pro models sooner or later, pretty quick. Unfortunately, it didn't work out that way. And not only myself, but other talented freestyle skaters lost out on huge opportunities. The times that we had back in the 1980s was way different than they are today. And it was a lot more challenging back then to even get any kind of recognition. You know, back then, photography for the magazines and getting in the videos was our social media.
Now let's watch a few moves from our home viewers. Now those guys sent their stuff in and got it on the air. Give you any ideas?
We didn't have a say in it for the most part. It was pretty much all up to the photographers, videographers, and the skate companies and the publishers. So yeah, it was pretty tough. It was a real challenge, and it was very competitive. We didn't have publishing
at the tips of our fingers, and we couldn't just put it up on the internet. We had to go out and constantly promote ourselves as side gigs in the freestyle community. Most of the time we had to do our own thing, and my oldest brother Terry and Lynn Cooper put together a freestyle magazine called G-Turn Freestyle Zine during the late 1980s. And that was just all about freestyle and help support the freestyle community in general. One thing's for certain, we all supported one another and we respected one another, and because we were just a very small, tight-knit community. I'm going to discuss some of the not-so-positive things that happened during the Pro-Am contest series in 1990. Things that I feel like I was cheated out on, and along with many others. And, you know, this just doesn't just apply to me. It applies to everyone who competed, especially the freestyle skateboarders. I know they were doing their best at the time to keep freestyle skateboarding alive, especially for the professionals, since the NSA quit holding the pro contests, and that was the whole intent. However, this has happened all during the hard hit recession of the late 80s, early 1990s, and a lot of companies were going under and bankrupt, and the contests were losing their sponsors, and there wasn't enough money to support the contests and pay the pros, you know, what they were worth. So the pros had to pretty much pay extra money for their entry fees in order to make the prize money a little worthwhile.
The special thing about this contest is it's fully funded by pro skaters.
But still, it wasn't enough for some of the pro freestylers, because some of them were complaining that there wasn't enough money included in the contests. I mean, the first contest turned out great. It was awesome. We had Rodney Mullen, Pierre Andre, Kevin Harris, Hans Lindgren, Fabian Kravitz, new pro Tim Aldusky, Bill Robertson, Lynn Cooper, and, you know, several others. We also had a professional announcer there too, which was great. Felt very respected.
Was one of our amateur national freestylers in the NSA finals, and he ended up ninth. John's riding for Kryptonics and Tracker.
Second and third contests that year did not turn out so great. There was not a very good turnout, all because there just wasn't enough money in it, and not many wanted to enter. Well, there was very few that continued to enter those contests, and the rest, a lot of the pros and sponsored AMs lost their sponsors, so a majority of the freestylers ended up quitting. Pretty much shortly after that, and mostly street skaters were coming to those contests because they were advertising them as flatland competitions in order to bring more interest into the freestyle contests. It was all right, but the atmosphere was not the same as it once was when we had mostly freestylers. The second Pro-Am contest, I mean, I did pretty well.
Woo! Good start. John did quite well already. Sorry, I won't go any louder.
I appreciate all the positive things that the announcer has said about me when he first started out announcing at these freestyle contests. However, you know, later on in the next contest, you'll see that there wasn't a whole lot of positivity going on and not a whole lot of support. So that kind of turned around pretty quick as soon as more freestylers started dropping out of contests and more street skaters started coming to the contests. And he just kind of turned it all into a joke.
Woo! John Rippin, skate for Vans and Tracker. 30 seconds remaining, John. John's older brother skated the pro. Winning $55.
My name is Bob, I got a real funky concept. Listen up, cause I'm gonna keep you in step. I got an idea.
And seventh place.
You don't like it, so what? I don't.
Hanging in there from the nose, really, to power slide. And that's time for John Trimble's fantastic first run.
I got third place, Joe Rickabosch got second, and George Nagai got first. But, you know, even though I placed higher than a couple of other longtime respected freestylers I competed with in the past, like Jeff Rickabosch and Mike Kinney, we were disrespected by the announcer after everyone received their trophies.
Steve Adio got 11th, and Jeremy Retiri got 12th. Wally Fiocchi, 9th place. 8th place goes to Robbie George. 7th place goes to Kevin Collins. 6th place goes to Brett Pyatt. 5th place goes to Jeff Rickenbosch. 4th place, Mike Kinney. 3rd place, John Trimble. John Trimble, good eye placing. 2nd place, Joe Rickabosch. Leaving the number 1 spot to George Nagai. Good skating, George. Quite impressive. I'd like to mention, this guy won a freestyle on a street style board. So,
mocked us, basically, and he's mocking freestyle and freestylers. That wasn't cool. And pretty much the disrespect kind of went downhill shortly after that, because at the third and final Pro-Am contest, first of all, my oldest brother was encouraging me to start skating on a mid-sized skateboard with mid-sized trucks and mid-sized board, because they're going to be changing the freestyle contest to flatland contests pretty soon, like the following year. And so he said, you should probably do it now and so you can be ahead of the game. And I did. I tested it out on a mid-sized board. And I did all right, except for some of the tricks that I used to do on freestyle. I wasn't able to do as well, even though it enabled me to do some street tricks easier. And I really ended up messing up quite a bit on my very first run. Messed up a lot, in fact. And I was laughed at by some street skaters because I fumbled all over my skateboard before I even could even get started. And I, you know, I pulled a few tricks after that, but then after that, most of my tricks I messed up really bad on. Partly because I was a little bit nervous you know, performing in front of like a newer audience and street skaters, and I wanted to do my best, and I didn't, you know, didn't want to let anyone down, and I just got a little too excited, I guess. But during that whole contest run, as I was messing up really bad, one guy kept asking, "What happened to John? What happened to John?
What happened to John? He hit his elbow."
No, I did not injure my elbow, and that story was all fabricated by someone who didn't really know what was going on with my skating at that time, so he just kind of made up a story. I ended my routine about 30 seconds before my time came up, because I knew it was just a throwaway contest run.
Stab about 30 seconds. Okay, I guess that's done.
I did better the second run, and I just eliminated, you know, one or two street tricks in there. I just focused on my freestyle. Did a lot better. But at the same time, there's this new kid. He ran right in front of me, right during my contest run, and that was extra distracting, and I got thrown off by that. That's never happened to me, by the way, in any contest. And then to top it off, nobody was watching, and the announcer was just continued to talk about just random stuff, and he kept announcing this kid's name.
Wesley, David Wesley, your mother is at the front gate. David Wesley, your mother's at the front gate. You need to go see her. David Wesley, you must go see your mother at the front gate. It could be Wes Davis. Wes Davis or David Wesley, your mother's at the front gate. You might want to go talk to her.
And that was distracting already enough as it is, and he just kept saying that over and over and over again.
And that's time for John Trimble.
Just the amount of disrespect was really pretty high at that point. You know, it's not all bad, considering when I was standing at the wall watching other skaters compete, Daryl Grogan approaches me behind me and he says, "Hey, I'm starting up a new team called Brand Effect. I was wondering if you'd be interested in skating for my team." It took me by surprise, like, "What, really? What?" And I said, "I don't know. I'd have to ask my brother because I'm still skating for Freestyle Underground." He said, "Oh, I didn't know. Sorry." He apologized. And I said, I'll get back to you, and I'll after I ask him." So I went over and I asked my brother, and he said, "Go ahead." I mean, he sounded a little bummed, but he was still pretty supportive of that. And it reminded me of the time on the movie North Shore where Chandler says to Rick King,
Go ahead. Go shred.
It kind of made me think of that. But anyhow, I was pretty excited and stoked for that. And considering, you know, Daryl has seen me skate for quite a long time over the years through contests and demos, and that meant a lot to me. And it really did make up for the crappy time that I had in the contest that day. The following year, I still competed in freestyle, but I could not compete in as many contests due to the recession. Yeah, I won 2 freestyle contests that year, which is all they held for that year because the third one got canceled. And you know, that's when they're really actually advertising it as Flatland contests, and they're trying to bring in as many street skaters as possible, because by then pretty much there was only a few of us freestyle skateboarders left. I got an NSA newsletter the following year indicating that they were gonna start doing flatland contests for the NSA as well. They did that as a trial run. They expected us to do some, implement some street tricks in our routines. They were hopeful that they're gonna get more street skaters coming in and hopeful that freestylers would wanna continue to compete and with the street skaters, but that didn't really work out so well because most of the freestylers quit because they didn't wanna compete with street skaters. So they pretty much gave up on freestyle contests altogether at that point. And it's unfortunate because it just it destroyed a lot of really talented freestylers' dreams and their ability to get promoted more in the magazines and in videos, and including myself. Our careers got cut short way too soon and not in our favor. Many kids of today's generation of skateboarding here between the early 2000s on through the 2020s and forward, as long as skateboarding keeps moving forward and progressing and doing well, they will never know what it feels like to have the rug pulled out from under them when they are just getting to their peak performance in skateboarding. I unfortunately do know what that feels like. It's heartbreaking.
I see people with talent, with all those things, but the one thing they don't have is that just love for doing it for the sake of it. Say, oh, I had that, I had a model, or I had all of these honors. Eventually, that stuff fades to just static. So when I see people who have had success, I see boredom for the most part in them. And then I see a tombstone. And circling back to what trophies and those things represented, right? Feynman. Usually when you get what you thought you wanted, the fire goes away.
The fire never left. It's just that for a while the industry and the economy left freestyle. And that's unfortunate. I'm glad to see that it has caught up again and it's doing well. And there's many other skaters have gained more interest in freestyle and more contests have been happening and there's been a lot more support. And I hope it continues that way.
You're up, John Trimble, skating four bands. Here we go, John Trimble.
At the time I skated in this final flatland freestyle contest in 1991, I'd never seen a lot of these street skaters before.
One of the few guys that takes freestyling more seriously. Good shows in his skating.
I got to see their skating, and they're pretty good with their flatland tricks. The one who I thought was a great skater, his name is Oscar Jordan, who you see there applauding at my skating, along with Daniel Castillo. Kareem Campbell showed some excitement too.
Competing with Daniel Castillo a year or two before competing with Day One Song in this 1991 Flatland Freestyle Contest. Daniel always had a natural skate ability, one of the rippers for sure.
Up. Got 15 seconds remaining in your run, Danny.
This 1991 Flatland Freestyle Contest was the first time I saw Day One.
After Day One will be Mike Marinaccio.
Not many knew him yet, because he was one of the newest competitors at the time. Even back then, he shined brightly with his level of technical tricks, creativity, and speed.
For
76 average, next skater up, Mike Marinaccio skating for Poorhouse. Do it up.
I don't remember competing with Mike Marinaccio prior to or after this contest. I can tell he was a good skater who might have just been having an off day. I've seen Jason compete for a few years and had been competing with him for about 1 year during this time. He was one of the top all-around competitors. Both Jason and I were close in overall points for the Castle Series 1 year.
David Ashley is up next.
I first met David Ashley at the 1989 NSA Nationals contest. He became quickly recognized for his photo getting mixed up with Brian Infante's name in the Power Edge magazine. It caused a bit of controversy. I remember David being a cool guy who also mixed freestyle with street.
We'd like to thank all the banner sponsors, such as Power Edge, Thunder, Independent, Gordon Smith, Trans World Skateboarding, Dogtown, Basic Skateboards, and numerous others, such as Castle, which is ourselves. Big pat on the back here. Tracker, Toxic, Pal Peralta, Sam's Thrasher, Vision, and a couple more. Yeah! We'd like to especially thank Toxic. They've been a big time sponsor for Castle last year and a half, I think. Still, I got a few more minutes. Or a few more seconds. Woo! And that's time for David Ashley.
Skater up is Pat Nielsen. Pat Nielsen.
Pat Nielsen was also one of the top all-around competitors through Castle. He had some natural talent in skateboarding as well.
Can you cruise on over here to the announcer stand?
John Trimble, skating four bands. Here we go, John Trimble.
Yeah. Woo! Right on the money. Unfortunately, he's not pro yet, huh?
What the announcer was really saying was that I should be competing in the pro division. A few others who knew I had been getting paid to skate in demos and Hollywood gigs for the past couple years encouraged me to compete in the pro division.
Yeah.
One thing that's unique and different about this particular contest, I had a feeling that this might be my very last flatland freestyle contest. So I asked my mom to go ahead and film the entire contest without stopping. She filmed every single competitor's contest runs, and I'm glad she did. This was the first and only time I pulled off the trick I invented in 1989 at this 1991 Flatland Freestyle Contest. I wanted to make sure I had it perfected before revealing it at a contest. The trick name, Trim Flip. This was one of my final freestyle performances in a contest. I felt that competing with street skaters on a freestyle board was awkward and an unfair advantage in my best element. I respect and skated all genres.
Okie dokie, that's time for John Trimble. You got a fan club, John.
We love you, John.
Don't leave here without getting a couple of numbers now. Okay, folks. Scores for John Trimble are 79, 78, 77 for a solid 78 average. Sixth place goes to Jason Pritchard. Where you at, Jason? Okay. Fifth place goes to David Ashley. David Ashley, fifth place. Plaque winner. And be sure to check your plaque just in case you don't have the right one. Okay, fourth place goes to Pat Nielsen of Santa Cruz. Pat Nielsen, where you at, Pat? Pat Nielsen, you got fourth place. Pick up your plaque. Once again, Pat Nielsen, pick up your fourth place plaque. Okay, here comes Pat. Okay, third place goes to Danny Castillo. Where you at, Dan? Okay, there he is. Second place is Daewon Song. Second place goes to Daewon Song. Second place, where you at, Daewon? Pick up your second place trophy. And first place belongs to John Trimble.
Yeah!
After seeing how those girls were over-exaggerating on their cheering, I was feeling skeptical because it's something I was not used to at all. Seeing just very few people there to begin with, and having a small section of girls cheering like that, made me feel like, is this a joke? Are they getting paid to cheer for us? It seemed a bit much in comparison to past contests that I was in. I tried to start competing in street more and doing better in street,
and I practiced that a lot more, but I just could not compete and catch up with these other guys who've been doing this for quite a while. Although I was doing fairly well, I mean, I learned how to ollie over fire hydrants. That was fun. And ollie up picnic tables, thanks to my good friend, street skater Wayne Deitch. Pretty stoked on that, you know. And I did learn how to ollie down 5 to 8 sets of stairs and do ollie melancholies, what they called them back then. I incorporated a lot of my tech skating with some of my street skating back then as well. I did learn how to slide down some handrails at different schools. One at the Scripps Ranch School, which they called School W. I did learn how to slide down ones built in skate parks. Practiced all summer, one summer, for a street contest that was held at the Magdalena Eck Family YMCA in Encinitas. And it was for 1993 to be exact. I think I did pretty well on that. I didn't really fall or anything, except for I missed one 540 shove it, but then I went ahead and I redid it at the very end. Even then, I mean, there were still a lot of really good street skaters that day, at least a dozen or more of us. And I guess my skating, even though I hit every single obstacle, it wasn't good enough to place the top 6. During those times when I don't do as well in the street contests, I usually make up for them in the slalom contests.
John Trimble running for Vans.
I did make up for it by placing 5th in a street contest against a lot of the same guys. It's not too bad. Anyhow, I pretty much quit competing after that because I just wasn't used to losing in competitions or not doing as well, even after working really hard at it all summer long and for quite some time. I was competing against guys like Bobby Coons and you know, even Daewon Song could not beat him in a contest. He even had expressed that in a video not too long ago. So, anyhow, we all have our strengths and weaknesses when it comes to different genres of skating and talents. I mean, I did beat Daewon Song in a flatline contest after all. I was doing freestyle back then, And I threw in a couple of street moves. Growing up as a freestyle skateboarder, I was made fun of by other skateboarders. And after a while, you begin to question other people's compliments towards you. And that's unfortunate. You know, being canceled out by the rest of the skateboarding community, you know, as a freestyle skateboarder, kind of makes me think about this whole entire cancel culture thing. You're always going to have favorites, and everyone's going to have a different patience for different things. In the 1980s, we always supported the older guys. Always. And we are just stoked to learn from them. We supported them, and we respected them. It just seems like on social media, yesterday's news is old news, and it's not relevant anymore. But I think that's absolutely wrong, because, you know, history is forever. Truly believe that history is forever, and it should never be forgotten and always respected. You know, we set the path for this newer generation and future generations. Without us, where would they be? They wouldn't get very far. They would not know where to even start with their tricks. Talking about tricks, you know, not too long ago, I was reading in one of the freestyle forums how they were discussing different trick names. And, you know, quite a few of them were expressing how they felt that naming your own tricks, and especially naming tricks after yourself, your own name, is pretty lame. And they were trying to figure out what else they could name these tricks. And I think that's actually disrespectful, considering, you know, we put a lot of time and hard work into these tricks throughout our careers. And back then, tricks that we discovered and we invented was basically our calling card. And especially for those who didn't have a pro model yet. Yep, those were our signature moves, and they were respected. And that's how we did things back then. And that should never be forgotten. It should never be rejected or changed or any of that. So after about 2 years of doing this trick behind me, I decided to revisit it. After doing more research, further research on this trick, the very first H Street video, and there's one guy, his name was Ben Job. I don't know if he's still around today, if he's still skating or not, but he's the only one that did this trick. His variation was different than mine, as I discovered when Tony Magnuson pointed that out to me. Upon more careful observation, and I was looking at frame by frame, I did notice he did, in fact, steps off the board, boom, the board comes up, straight up, and his knee comes up, hits it, and it rotates 180 degrees, and then he lands on it like that. That's the same variation that Jason Park was demonstrating after he had watched a video of Chris Haslam doing it. So after I did further research beyond watching the 1988 Shackle Me Not 8th Street video with Ben Job, a couple years later I came across a video, late 1980s pro skater who I didn't know at the time until recently in the past couple years. He had posted a video that I saw maybe a couple months ago where he's doing just a regular pressure flip, no comply pressure flip, but it flips in the same way that my variation does, but he remains looking forward while keeping his eyes focused straight down on the board. Each of those variations are pretty difficult to master, and it took me probably about a good year or two, maybe three, before I could just do it without even any thought. So the variation that I discovered and invented sometime between December of 1988 and February of 1989.
This is gonna show proof that I started to work on my trick that I invented, the trim flip, that I call it now. At the time it was called the front side 180 no comply pressure flip to be exact. So here he goes. There I am. There you see me trying it right there.
I had been watching Ray Barbie on the 1988 Public Domain, where he's doing his full 360 degree no complies. And I was trying to do that in my parents' garage. And as I was doing that, I was just popping it really high. And then as I was trying to turn a 360 degrees with the board really fast, the board just over rotated in flipping right as I was in midair. And I was like super excited and stoked for that, because right then and there I was like, holy crap, I think I just came up with a new variation of the no comply. And I just completely forgot about doing the 360 no comply, and I worked on the flipping method, which I didn't have a name for it at the time. I was just so excited. I wanted to learn this trick and get it down good. It took me probably a good couple of days until I got it.
And this is the first time I actually was pretty confident enough that I could do it in front of an audience. And I did pull it once, right there. I started to lean a little too far forward, and I braced myself.
We didn't have a name for the variation that I came up with until maybe a few years later. One of my good friends at the time, Jeff Everett, he was telling me,
do a pressure flip, no comply, switch stamp. Yeah.
So I was like, oh, okay. I think I know what he's talking about.
But even then, back then, it didn't really sound quite right, but it was pretty close. So fast forward like 20, 30 years later, I thought about it for a while and I was like, okay, so you're doing a frontside 180 no comply, but at the same time, you're flipping the board. So it's kind of like a kickflip, 180 kickflip, but it's not, it's more like a pressure flip, because if it was a kickflip, you'd be using your front foot, but if you're using your back foot, it's more like a pressure flip. And I'm using my back foot and it's flipping off the outside of the board, okay? Other skaters who might have discovered this on their own without seeing any other past videos, they may have gotten really excited that thinking that this was their invention or idea, their puzzle trick, whatever they want to call it. I understand that. It's exciting when you discover something or you feel like you discovered it on your own, whether or not you've seen videos of other people doing that in the past. I have seen plenty of videos of Thandi Anderson doing a frontside 180 no comply pressure flip, but he's doing opposite direction because, you know, he's goofy foot. Frontside 180 no comply pressure flip, that's a really long name, so I had to come up with an official name for this only after I had done my thorough research on this and discovered that I was pretty much the first to invent this variation. Originally I was gonna call it the Trimble flip, but that didn't really roll off the tongue so well, so then I just shortened it to Trim flip, kind of like half cab. And it's really important for, you know, skaters like me who grew up skating and didn't receive as much opportunities as other pro skaters out there because of how the economy was and there wasn't a whole lot of money in skateboarding. So basically our signature move that we discovered and came up with was our calling card, and that was extra important to us, and that's something to have a lot of pride in. So there you have it. The frontside 180 no comply pressure flip, aka the Trim flip. You know, it's perfectly fine for an athlete and a skateboarder to name their own tricks. It's no different than an artist signing their own work. It's their trademark and their stamp of approval. One thing you never want to do is to doubt and discriminate against other people's experiences based on your lack of perception and understanding. If you do, you're the one who's going to be missing out on things. You know, over the years, when I competed for like 7 years straight in skateboarding, and I got into competitive art competitions, I was always a high achiever, and I always wanted a constant challenge for myself. And I've seen others do that as well, while supporting each other. And that's great, that's positive. However, there's a downside to competition, especially when those who become overly competitive and they to the point where they are criticizing others while building themselves up.
See, I grew up with two other brothers that were close in age, and we were always competing with each other. And sometimes they'd get really ugly to the point where we were actually fighting, fist fighting. That's not good. Someone ends up getting hurt, and then just the whole competition, just which started out as a healthy, fun competition, just gets ruined. A healthy way to compete is to really compete for yourself, and so that you can constantly improve upon your own skills and abilities. Something you can feel good about and not have to feel like you're stepping on someone else's toes or trying to hurt somebody else in the process. That's really what it's all about.
They say action speaks louder than words. One guy who I skateboarded with and competed with during the 1980s, he was really good skater too. And we both went back and forth a little bit on placings and stuff. And his very last competition was the 1989 Nationals competition. And then shortly after that, freestyle was pretty much gone. It was dying off. The word was out that there wasn't going to be any more pro contests. So him and several others pretty much quit. And they went off to join the armed services. And, you know, they did their thing. And everyone else went their separate ways, except for maybe a few of us who stuck around to compete with the street skaters in the Flatland contests. Your perspective on what your experiences are going to be completely different from mine or anyone else's. I saw the similarities between when I was skating professionally, getting paid to do demos for the inline skateboard and put on their flyers, compared to when I was skating in demos, getting paid to do that with my name attached to a major company at the time, which was Vision Streetwear.
John has been riding for over 3.5 years and is paying off now for John Trimble. All right, John, supported by Vision Streetwear.
That made me a professional skateboarder because, according to the National Skateboarding Association, of which I was competing in at the time, they say that you are not allowed to be represented from any kind of a skateboard company while getting paid to skate in demonstrations. I told Gail about this, what I found out and discovered through the NSA code. In her own words, she was compensating us for gas and food, and for any kind of equipment or supplies to help further our career. In the NSA rules, it also says, but this is only applies to the competitions. An amateur is allowed to receive compensation for gas and food and any kind of equipment or any kind of compensation for anything that comes up for insurance purposes or whatever. But that does not apply to being advertised through skateboarding while you're skating in demonstrations, performing your skills, talents, and abilities, while getting paid to do that. I asked my oldest brother, Terry, later on, who also happened to be working closely with Sonia Catalano of the California Amateur Skateboard League and the National Skateboarding Association, why am I not allowed to tell anyone I'm getting paid in the shows? Because, well, basically, my brother knew and understood the rules back then, and he pretty much said, if you tell anyone in Castle or NSA or Sonia you're getting paid in the Galweb shows, she'll make you compete as a pro. There really was no difference there at all. I was getting paid to skate, to show my skills, while being advertised through a company, a skateboard company, legit one. And we're not given the same opportunities or equal opportunities as street skaters and vert riders back then, and we all know that. And it sucks, but that's just how it was. Not enough people were interested in freestyle at the time. There was not a whole lot of money in it, so they didn't really advertise it and promote it as much, unfortunately. It would have been nice if they promoted it a little bit more, but that's just how the ball rolls sometimes, especially when there's not a whole lot of money in the industry and they don't have a whole lot of money to shell out for to advertise and promote all aspects of skateboarding. So anyhow, it was all pretty good experiences back then for the most part.
So I was technically skating professionally while getting paid to skate in demos and Hollywood gigs.
Your experiences are yours. Mine experiences are mine. Don't ever discount what my experiences are, because what I went through and experienced are all valid and reasonable. Thanks.
I said it once, and I'll say it again. Determination gives you the resolve to keep going in spite of the roadblocks that lay before you. Interest, motivation, and persistence are the three ingredients that drives passion and determination. Look, you can't get ahead in life by blowing out someone else's candle. If you want to get ahead in life, you gotta take some risks and put in the work. And those who do will reap the rewards and benefits. Those who sit back and criticize others while trying to dismiss their efforts, they do so because they are either feeling inferior and inadequate, or jealous and envious. There will always be someone out there who will criticize you for your efforts, or they'll just tell you no, that you can't do that. But don't take that as a failure on your part. Take it as an opportunity to continue to work towards the things that you are most passionate about. Stay focused on your goals and your dreams and follow through with them. And when you can do that, don't give power to the voices of critics out there. You will persevere
towards your goals and dreams, and you will come out on top, and you will find the road to your success.
It is not the critic who counts. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly. And when you finally fly away, I'll be hoping that I served you well. For all the wisdom of a lifetime, no one can ever tell. But whatever road you choose, I'm right behind. Determination gives you the resolve to keep rolling forward in spite of the roadblocks that lay before you. Oops, and I just tripped over a twig. Overly exaggerating on their... So I've talked a little bit about success and how to achieve that. However, I haven't really focused so much on happiness. Now, when it comes to happiness, there are two different ways to achieve that. One is how you manage yourself when you feel like you have little to nothing in life. And the second way is how you behave when you feel like you've already achieved everything you ever wanted, or you feel like you have everything you need. Now, there are some people out there who just aren't happy with themselves, period, because of they are either overachievers and they're just too critical of themselves and others, and they'll just never be happy no matter how much they have earned and received
and been rewarded. And that's a shame. Then you have those who continually strive for things and work hard at stuff. And they are proud to receive what they have earned.
I choose to hold on to my trophies because it's not only a great reminder of my personal accomplishments and how good I was at a certain aspect of my life, like skateboarding. And it showed, it's a reminder to me that I can work hard towards something. And when I do set my mind to something, I can achieve whatever I want. If you really want to make something happen, you got to put forth the effort and determination, and you got to be consistent. Holding on to my trophies also helps me to want to persevere and keep moving forward in whatever other things I enjoy doing in my life. And that's important to me because, you know, I show a lot of pride in those trophies and a lot of gratitude as well. And that just helps remind me of how grateful I am for the gifts that I've been given and to not take that for granted and to, you know, utilize those gifts and skills that I have and keep pushing forward in other ways, in other talents that I have, like with art, fine art, digital art, filming, and animation, whatever kind of multimedia artistic expression is out there.
And it's okay to give yourself a pat on the back once in a while. That's what I consider healthy self-esteem. And some of the most happiest people in life you'll find are those individuals. Look for those people. Thanks.